Thank you very much. I am so honoured to be here. I'm absolutely delighted because it was in 1992 that we did set up Forum for the Future, or started to talk about it. It took us a few years to get organised and go public. And we were indeed prompted by the 1992 Rio Summit, which we were pretty fed up with. And we were also concerned that the Green Movement was so negative. It was really good at pointing out how things were going wrong and not very good at pointing to things that were going right. And that's essentially what Forum for the Future does, is work in partnership on solutions. So I hope I'm going to press the right thing. Yes, I am. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to have a short, I'm the light entertainment amongst this lot here. I'm coming from a campaigning perspective. I'm going to indulge in a short CES love-in. I'm going to look back a little bit, and I'm going to look back a bit longer than 20 years. I'm going to then have a look at some post-Rio strategies. So just in the way that you are, I'm going to do it from a Green Movement perspective. So I'm going to come up with a range of research questions which are actually the biggies that we are wrestling with, and some of the ones that I think that if we can do something on that will make the biggest difference. And I'm going to have a talk about leadership and universities at the very end, and then I hope I'm going to have a rattling good party. Good. CS Heartthrob number one. In 1990, it was just after the Green Party had got 15% in the European elections, and I was invited everywhere, including to address the Engineering Council's annual conference. And I was really quite frightened about this, and I berated in the nicest possible way engineers' failure to get onto the sustainability agenda, because they actually knew the science about sustainability and they weren't really doing anything about it. And shortly after that, I got involved with a writing of some guidelines. And what they had done was they had done some guidelines on risk, and we had a draft, and they'd snowpaked out the word risk and put in environment. And they thought it would be just rubber stamped and it'd be all over. I met with the directors of the secretary generals of the big engineering institutions to try and say, how can we work together? And I was told, not very politely, that there were 49,682 engineering jobs and all of them were environmentalist. And thank you and goodbye. So when I fell upon Roland, it was just a blessed relief. And I haven't got time to tell you all the escapades that we got up to down the years, but there were a few. Heartthrob number two. You need to know that I was a great fan of an American economist called Robert Hepbronner. He wrote a book when he was 25 called The Worldly Philosophers, and it was published in 1957. And it was about all the big economists, the person and their theories. And I must have read it in the 1960s, early 70s. And it completely got rid of my fear of economics, because he wrote about these people and about the ideas, Adam Smith, Maynard Keynes, all the rest of them. And he talked about Adam Smith used to live with his mum, and he used to be absent-minded and walk around Edinburgh in his dressing gown. So it sort of diffused the fear of these great economic ideas. And so I was very grateful for that. And then my next big sort of hero was Tim, because he was actually talking about the idea that economics does not have to be the way it is at the moment. It can be different, we can do things differently. And that was, again, a great relief to me, and you helped us set up the master's programme, the economic strand of our master's programme. And he had an absolutely brilliant pair of blue and white striped trousers, which I was terribly impressed by. They were brilliant, and all the students thought this was absolutely wonderful. So there is my heartthrob number two. But I want to look, what difference has the last 20, or more precisely, the last 40 years made? Because it's a confidence trick. If you think that 1992 was the first Earth Summit, it was 40 years ago, 1972, in Stockholm. And that is really important that we remember that. And at the time, there was an enormous amount of publications then, Limits to Growth, Blueprint for Survival. And this is what the definition, the principles of a sustainable society were in 1972 in the Blueprint for Survival. And I still think it remains one of the best articulations of sustainability, where we want to end up. Now, we thought the intellectual argument was won. We were breakfasting in the corridors of power. Environment departments were set up. The United Nations Environment Programme was started in Nairobi, nice safe distance. And in retrospect, it was probably a big mistake that we celebrated the setting up of environment departments, because it permitted governments to marginalise the environment. So that actually has been, I think, one of the errors, that whether we could have done anything about it or not, I don't know. Now, as you said, as Matt said, I talked to NATO officers, and this is one of the recent overheads I've done, summing up some of the big trends over the last 40 years, from 1972 right through to today. And they are quite startling, because you see the population as the big multiplier. The ones in yellow are per capita trends, and the others are gross. So there is really quite a lot of worry about the fact that all the big major trends are actually not getting better. They're getting worse. There is a lot to celebrate. I get into trouble for being showing this too often, because we have to think positively, but we've also got to be realistic. And of course, down the bottom, there is GDP, and countries still compete on who's got the biggest GDP of them all. So what's the same? What's different? These unchecked trends, inadequate response. But what's different now is there is a wide recognition we have a mega challenge on our hands, exploding inequality, and we can actually watch the suffering of people around the world online in real time. Moreover, they know that we are watching, and they know how we are reacting. So there is a kind of change in the dynamic between the rich and the poor, which is significant. We did have an opportunity to consider whether we were all right with progress, but then there was a huge How the West Has Won hubris. That was an article written in a leader in The Economist in 1990, and the opportunity missed. If you look at the top picture on the wall, I don't know if you can see it, it says fresh food, fresh people. These are photographs I took in February 1990. And the other wall has got a broken off, ripped off, half ripped off, Saatchi and Saatchi sticker. And that kind of sums up the choice that was facing what was going to happen in Germany, particularly East Germany. And the choice made was Saatchi and Saatchi, and the big corporations were building on the no man's land, which was supposed to be a peace park, was the proposal wanted by many people. And here's another one. I'm in the right place at the right time. This picture was taken on the day Merrill Lynch sold itself to Bank of America. It is their logo, and it's in the hall, I don't know if it's still there, in a foyer of their offices, and it's made of rubbish. And so, you know, that's the sort of kind of nemesis for the hubris that meant that we said the West had won in 1992. Now, there is a real crisis in the economy, and Tim's probably going to talk more about it, and it depends whether we see this as Mark Twain said, when we lost sight of their goals, we redoubled our effort, whether we're going to keep trying to get the old model on the road, or whether we see it's an opportunity to get new thinking into power. So here's research question number one. Why are we not responding appropriately to these big challenges, both environmental and social? Just what is it that is really preventing it happening? I've got this is something I sort of gave to my friendly NATO officers. I think there's some demand side, which is essentially us as citizens. We are getting worried that the environment is being perceived as more important than people. And I think that's one of the things we have to think about, that, you know, if you look at what's happened in the recession, there's been a drop in the purchasing of organic food, but actually fair traded goods, there's been an increase. So there is something that we really need to take notice there. And I think also the ignorance about basic physics and biology, and also about how the systemic nature of our problems, sort of compartmentalization, the disciplines that Roland talked about. Some supply-side government reasons, a real failure of leadership, because governments are widely sustainability illiterate. Most of them are not trained at all, even in just ordinary leadership, never mind leadership for sustainability. And they're very frightened of losing control. And a lot of the way that the green movement and academics and intellectuals talk to them about climate change and other things actually doesn't recognize that is their main fear. They are really frightened of losing control. So I think the way we actually offer solutions needs to change. Capture of governance systems, the corruption, I don't need to spend any time on any of that. So post Rio tristesse, that's some of the quotes about what people thought about the Rio conference last week. And I just wonder if the good thing that's come out of it is there is a recognition that the route to doing anything isn't through these big conferences, and that we are on our own. And so we need to think about that. So research question number two, is the green movement ready to succeed? What would success look like? And I sort of figure the green movement as being having four divisions as the sort of single issue campaigners, practitioners, policy and idea merchants, the category into which you fall. There's the moles who are in other organisations. We've had the Archbishop of Canterbury wading in with great vigour. And there are people in all sorts of organisations who think the same and are trying to affect change where they are. And we've got the green political parties, who theoretically should be taking all of the demands and the examples and the good ideas and putting them into a democratic option at election time. But is the green movement even able to say what good looks like? I don't know if you've read any manifestos of any party talking about what they think sustainability would look like. It's not very well done. Are they savvy about power? Absolutely not. Are they capable of strategic subversiveness? Which is another way of saying positive deviance, which I'm particularly keen on. And there's two, Wangari Maathai. I don't know if you remember, she was the leader of the Green Belt movement, Nobel Prize winner, who died not very long ago. But she, with women in Kenya, developed these seedlings in batches of 1,000, and they took them to villages to be planted. Now, the United Nations thought this was a brilliant program. They gave pots of money to do this all over Africa. They replicated it all over the place. But what they didn't know, it was hugely subversive. And it was the message that went with the trees was empowering of women, and it was also family planning, nutrition. So it was a hugely subversive program. And I think that all of us should read, you mentioned sort of neoconservative, Richard Cockett, who wrote Thinking the Unthinkable, which is about how the neoconservatives got their ideas into power, the strategies they used between 1930 and 1983. And Tim Lang, who's professor of food policy and City University, gives it to all his students to read. And it's that being savvy about how you get ideas into power, which I don't think we've got, whichever bit of the green movement we are in. This is for you, Ian, Christie. I think the Greens have, the sort of whole green movement has not got it. It is saying you must vote for us because we are not left, we are not right. But what they haven't understood that they are actually the alternative to the extreme political parties that thrive at times of fear and uncertainty, which is happening all over Europe. And I think that they don't understand that that is their role. And these are two books, The Politics of the Real World, which a coalition of NGOs from all different social and environmental strands of the movement. We published it in 1996 in time for the 1997 election. And John Major called out the Charity Commission and said, these guys shouldn't be doing this because they're charity. Really put the frighteners on them. But instantly, soon as Labour was elected, all the Green NGOs went back into their holes and said, well, we're all right now. Labour will do it for us. And From Here to Sustainability was a 2001 effort to do the same. Ian was one of the authors of it for us. But again, the movement dissipated. It didn't realise its power, and it didn't use its power. That's my response, a book about positive deviance. And I forgot to bring all the flyers, but I'm sure your library can order it. So on to what would a transforming research agenda look like? Now, there's lots of basic things that really I think most researchers know. But I think we're in such a position of urgency now. I think we have to take what I call a crumbly brick strategy, which is identify where we're more likely to get things through and get things happen and bring down the wall, because we can bang our heads against it and we won't shift it, but by scratching it away at some really key areas, we can do it. I don't need to talk to you about taking a sort of non-disciplinary approach, so it's more than trans, it's more than multi, but a non-disciplinary approach to think about what are the big problems and how are we going to address them, and then bring in the people, whether they're from a discipline or outside the sector, to do it. I think research question number three, I think we've lost the language. I mean, Tim, you did this with sort of prosperity means more than just wealth, but I think we have to go further than that. Resilience is what we're after, a social and environmental resilience. Capital. Everybody uses the word capital on its own to mean money. They don't qualify it. So I think there is a challenge in actually getting back the meaning of words that really are important to us. The Media Trust produced a very good booklet for journalists on racism to actually help them manage the terminology and the language in a way that meant that the meanings of the words were given proper meanings. This is probably the easiest way to hit our greenhouse gas emission targets. These are the high fertility, intermediate and low fertility rates for low projection, medium projection and high projections, which have just been produced by the UN, right up to 2100. And if you look down at the bottom corner here, here you can actually see if we can hit the lower projection of 6.2 billion by 2100, we will have more or less got ourselves on track for the reduction of CO2 emissions. The importance about having the three different countries divided into three different sorts of fertility. In the middle one is the US. It's not a low fertility country, it's a middle fertility country. and you can see the lower curve drops off much more quickly than the median. And we are on target at the moment to go above the median. So the technology is simple. It's the cheapest technology for reducing CO2 emissions that there is. And the collateral benefit to women is absolutely enormous. The demand is there. It's not being met. So why are we not actually making that a major area for progress? Another key question for people like me is, and you, is how to end the career of cash as a commodity. How do we stop measuring things in terms of GDP? How do we stop thinking that we have to go where the money is? Why can't we actually say, well, we want to do things that build natural capital, build and grow human and social capital, and do that with confidence, because the money will follow if we actually do that, because that is where we will get a new sort of economy. And so I think that's, Tim's no like going to talk about this a lot more, but it is a bit, it's an intellectual challenge to move off the territory and the parameters of debate that is provided by the way economics is thought of now, and to actually say, okay, we want to build natural human, we want to grow natural human and social capital, doing that sort of thing, huge amount of activity, for a new type of economy, and the money which will facilitate it will follow. And how to make trade really fair matters. As I said, fair trade has held up and increased over the recession, more than organic food consumption in this country. And we want to grow local food. We want to buy our pineapples and our coffee from poor communities in other countries, but are they going to have a diverse, resilient local economy as well as us? Just what would trade, a sort of sustainable global trade system, look like? What percent would we trade locally here, round about where we are? What would we trade UK-wide? What would we trade in Europe? What would we trade further afield? And actually to think about those sorts of resilient communities in different parts of the world and how you can actually get a full chain of trade that is fair, something that's not really been tackled. Okay, here's one, how to do as little work as possible. You sort of talked about having barbecues. I was in Rio not long after the summit in 1992 visiting a project which brought dirty water down from the favelas, put it through all sorts of horticultural snail growing type things to get clean water back into the river. I was being shown round by the project manager, who just happened to be German, and there were a couple of Brazilian workers sitting under a tree in the shade. It was the noonday sun and the German and myself were in it. And he said, this country will never develop because all they want to do is sit under trees and gossip and hold fiestas. And I said to him, hang on a minute, I think that sounds like a good idea. So how have we actually got a sort of lifestyle that we not only follow, but we preach elsewhere? That means that unless you're working flat out, there's something wrong with the system. Why are we not saying, how can we get what we would like to have with the minimum work possible? And I think that moves into thinking about the challenges between the third of the life I've spent in education, the third of the life I've spent in work, and if, you know, I hope I'm not going to be put out to pasture just yet, but, you know, I could have 30 years of idleness. So why have we got that kind of crazy way of organising our life? So that's a question. Now that is a picture of the island of Islay, in which is my home, and that's taken at the beginning of January by a friend. And so I think one of the big questions is how do we do extreme community energy? So that means instead of just nice little projects to put stuff on the roof, how do we get big about it? Now, Isla is developing community interest company that is going to put in place a really huge turbine. And that's going to generate a very, very large amount of energy. There's going to be several of them. There's also going to be offshore windmills. And you may say, well, that sounds just great, lucky old Isla. But there will be an awful lot of money. There will be an awful lot of energy. So how do you actually handle that on a local basis so that you are sharing it? How do you make sure that there are sustainability outcomes for the environmental gains that you're going to get? And the taxes, one of the reasons big energy is doing so nicely, it's sort of nicely protected, is that it's got a big tax delivery into government, so big it gets subsidised. Well, what would it look like if we were all devolved doing our own regional energy generation? Highly efficient, low in carbon, with lots of social benefit. What would the picture look like? How to achieve radical and just localism? I think this is again, and it's difficult in our country where the opposite is kind of happening, but the post-Rio sentiment of just do it in your locality is likely to sort of carry on. How do we do it? How do we achieve the sort of local arrangements that are radical, but they're also just in the way we have relationships with each other? Sir Jeremy Greenstock, who was UN ambassador, ambassador to the UN, pointed out that really everything's going local, but the challenge is how do you build on that without tribalism coming in? So we need to have a vision of what a really localised economy would look like. We need models to make so we can articulate and solve problems on a broader canvas. Some of you might recognise that as from the Stern report, and it was a diagram put in with tranches of ideas that would reduce CO2 emissions, and there were 1 billion tonnes of greenhouse gases per tranche. And this was the Princeton wedges. Now, all of the 15, they came up as options, four and seven of them needed to work, were technology. Big technological changes in cars and energy systems. One was about planting trees. None were about the social changes that would have to take place if this was going to be acceptable, if it's going to happen. So I think it is really important that we have models whereby we can articulate problems and we can actually diagnose ways of solving them so that we hit all the sustainability outcomes that we can. And to end, a coda, leadership and the role of universities. Rosenstock Huse was a refugee from Nazi Germany. Does anybody recognise this? He went to Dartmouth, he was a professor of, I think, philosophy in Dartmouth University in the US. And this is my favourite quote about what the role of universities should be. And I think we're at a situation now, as he said then, you know, after the Second World War, the rethinking of civilization, the refounding of civilization, we need to do something similar now. And so how can universities really take the leadership role of making sustainability the norm? You've talked about a module, but what about the whole university? What about nobody leaving this university who is not sustainability literate? Because we have to gear up people that quickly if we are going to make the sort of difference. Because at the moment, next to nothing's happening, and where leadership is taught, in business schools, there is really, it's not very good. There's not really very much change at all. And this is from a report produced by the US National Intelligence Council given to Obama in 2008 that points out that it's going to be the quality of leadership that will dictate whether things get worse or whether things get better. And the end, it is a moral question. And I think the interesting thing at the moment, we've got a prime minister who's talking about morality of this, that, and the next thing. And I don't know if any of you read Peter Singer, who wrote on the ethics of George Bush. He did an extreme sort of diagnosis of all George Bush had said and done to try and find what his ethic was, and he didn't find one. And David Cameron has been made co-chair of the group that is going to design the sustainability goals that take over from the Millennium Development Goals. So I think an interest in the morality of somebody who's going to do that is really perhaps something that needs to happen. And that living in truth comes from another person who's had a major, major impact on me, and that is Vaclav Havel in when he was president of Czechoslovakia. He was a major dissident, which is when I knew him. And his living in truth meant that he was living in a repressive regime as if it was free. And he spent a lot of time being thrown into jail. But he said it's the only way to live is to live in truth as if it was free. And I think that's a challenge to all of us, that we had to live as if sustainability was a reality. And if we can do that in our private and in our professional lives, then that will do more than anything to actually make it come to pass. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. Sarah, thank you so much. You've so generously given us the most challenging of research agendas with a lot of very insightful comments, as well as the love in at the start. And we can certainly offer you the nice drinks and dinner, I think, to come a little bit later on. We're not going to take questions now because our keynote speakers will be joining us on the panel shortly, and there will be some opportunity then to pose some questions to them. So we're going to move ahead now to our second keynote. Let me bring up his presentation. Tim has already had a good deal of introduction, including hearts and stars and all sorts of things. In terms of a slightly more formal introduction, Tim Jackson is our second keynote speaker. Since 2000, he's been a professor of sustainable development here at the University of Surrey. It was the first such chair of sustainable development to be created in the UK. And as such was, you know, clearly a first for the UK, and it's been an enormous benefit to this university to be in that position. In 2006, he founded the research group Resolve, which brought together economists, psychologists, sociologists, others from CES, for the first time really to explore the complex links in this area between lifestyles and the environment. More recently, Tim is now directing the DEFRA ESRC-funded Sustainable Lifestyles Research Group. And for me, it's fantastic to see the progression from something funded by the research councils through to something which is now primarily funded by government. And there's a clear demonstration, I think, about the progression from research through to impact. Tim has also written extensively, and it's been referred to tonight, around the relationship between economy and the environment and sustainability. And in 2004, he was appointed as the Economics Commissioner for the UK Sustainable Development Commission. And through that, he led a five-year project on redefining prosperity. And that culminated in the publication, in 2009, of the book Prosperity Without Growth, Economics for a Finite Planet. And since that time, and certainly in the last year or two, he's been trotting the globe, both launching multiple publications in new languages, translations of that book, but also engaging really with a who's who of academics, thinkers, and political people on the transition to a green economy and some of the things that Sarah was talking about. He's just back from Rio Plus 20. And Tim, I think I should give the floor to you.
Thank you very much indeed. It's great to be here. As I walked into the room today, it was like the concertina of time collapsing. The still rather young PhD students from earlier times accosting me and saying, "So you're still here then?" Yes, I'm still here. Who knows for how much longer, when I've insulted as many people as I can this evening. It's my one chance to get my own back. I have had a fantastic opportunity, and it was Roland who presented it to me shortly after that fateful meeting when we met in Santa Barbara, saying, "Would I like to come and work here?" And little did I know actually at that time how rich an experience it would be, but I am profoundly grateful, Roland, to you for that opportunity, to those of my colleagues who've made my life easier. Matt said very generously that I direct the Sustainable Lifestyles Research Group. Those of you closer to me know that that's only a partial truth. Actually, it's Ian Christie who's doing much of the work behind it, and Gemma who's keeping my diary afloat, and my PhD students who are keeping me young and invigorated with ideas and with inspiration. And to them all, I'm profoundly grateful. I want to talk a little reflectively. I want to situate what CES has done, although Roland declines to do so. I want to situate it in terms of Rio and Rio Plus 20, and that's partly because I'm just back from there and because it seems important, I think, to reflect on our place, our history in the light of this broader history. And also because there were things said in Rio which were almost unforgivable. And I think that if we are a legitimate institution with a future out there saying things in the world, we should actually say that they were unforgivable and that there are actually voices that clamor to be heard, that were clamoring to be heard in Rio, not necessarily in Rio Centro, but in the People's Summit, for example, that are speaking to agendas of social justice that are profoundly important in the world. And our job, it seems to me, is to identify where we should sit back and be kind, reflective, intellectual academics with strong disciplinary background and a good report to the REF in next year, and where we should actually engage vigorously as human beings, as citizens, as intellectuals, as academics, and do, as Sarah was suggesting, Vaclav Havel suggested, to live in truth and to speak truth. But let me start just a little backstory, and it's very, very familiar. It's almost the first thing we gave you when you came here to be students, the impact equation, the sustainability equation. Impact equals population times affluence times technology. And I want to start here because it seemed to me that in 1992 in Rio, this is the backstory. The backstory is how we failed to look at this equation and see it for what it was. Actually, what happened was in Rio in 1992, for the most part, the developing countries said to the developing countries, "You have to do something about your population. It's your population that is the problem. By the time we get to the end of the millennium, there'll be 7 billion people approaching it on the planet. That is too many. You need to make some change in relation to population." Fertility rates are 6.2 in some of those least developed countries. And this is clearly a place where you can have some influence. Not surprisingly, quite justifiably, the developing countries complained about that vociferously at the time. In fact, it was instrumental in forming the G77 group of developing countries. And they turned around and they said, "Actually, guys, you have a carbon footprint, you have an ecological footprint, you have a resource footprint that is still 10 and 20 times the average of countries even in the industrializing nations. You should be thinking about consumption. You should be thinking about affluence. You should be thinking about what is a decent level of affluence in a global society which is limited by ecological constraints." George Bush Sr. was having none of it. He said, and it's historical now, the American way of life is not up for negotiation. Affluence was off the table. And so everything that was left, really, after Rio was a set of assumptions that technology would save us. that we are a clever enough species to transform our engineers, to transform our engineering systems, to transform our technologies, to engage in renewable energy, to do resource productivity extreme, to borrow from Sarah's lovely phrase, and to turn the whole thing around. And I've shown pictures of the assumptions that that would make, for example, about the carbon intensity of each dollar of economic output over the last year or so. And sometimes, in some of those talks, really bright, engaged, enthusiastic technology students and engineering students will come up to me and say, yes, that is doable. Just show me the challenge. Show me how far we have to go. Do we really have to go to 130-fold improvement in the carbon intensity of our activity? Let's just do it. Do we have to get to an economy that is pulling carbon out of the atmosphere by the end of this millennium? Let's just do it. Never mind that we don't know what such an economy looks like. Never mind that technologists can't tell us. Never mind that the economics of it doesn't work. Never mind that there isn't a politician anywhere who can tell you what such a society looks like. Let's just do it. And I applaud that. I think at the same time, though, we have to, before we engage in that activity, ask ourselves whether it's reasonable. And we have to acknowledge what I would call the battle of efficiency against scale. Of course, we can do a lot more things very, very efficiently. Of course, we have a lot of technology that will improve the situation. Of course, renewable energy has huge potential. Of course, resource productivity has hardly been tried. But when we look at the evidence, what we see in the past is that every single improvement in efficiency is overtaken by expansions of scale. That's what we saw exactly in the period between 1992 and now. We saw actually around a 30% improvement in the energy efficiency of the global economy, and yet energy consumption actually increased. So our ideas, our heroic ideas about technology, about efficiency, about what we can achieve have to be tempered, I would argue, by this understanding that the scale of things continually sweeps away the gains from efficiency. And here exactly is how that happened in terms of carbon emissions between the two Rio summits. Carbon emissions increased by around 48% since 1992. And the only thing that remotely slowed them down, and you can see it in the corner there, was a global recession. Here is the graph against the GDP, and what you can see here shows in some places something like a kind of relative decoupling of carbon emissions from the expansion of the economy. But overall, there is no absolute decoupling. There's no sense in which we've ever overcome the battle of efficiency against scale. Efficiency has never won out against scale in the global arena. And we have to recognize that. We have to say that what's at the heart here, and what's the most crucial point to recognize here, I think, is the ideas around global expansion. CES has played, I think, a very interesting role in this story, in this backstory. It certainly started, and it started with Roland's very strong instinct that engineers had a part to play. But Roland himself brought into that dialogue the sociologists, the psychologists, he brought the economists, he brought the would-be philosophers and mathematicians, I'm referring to myself here, he brought a whole range of people because he saw, in fact, that we had to ask more difficult questions, deeper questions about the nature of our economies, the nature of our societies, the way that technology is integrated into society, and indeed the way that we see basic things about social progress. What does social progress mean to us? And these are questions that can never be answered purely by engineers, but the engineering foundation of CES was absolutely vital. It's something that I've benefited from myself. My supervision of engineering doctoral students, my engagement in the issues of industrial ecology and clean technology, the strong foundational work that has been a thread throughout CES's history in low carbon energy systems, and that Matt is now leading vigorously are still the foundation, it seems to me, of our understandings of sustainability and sustainable technology. My sense that the broadening of our ideas needed to be reaching out to other disciplines was strengthened by my understanding and my engagement of sustainable consumption. If we were to put back in that equation the unaskable question about consumption, where would it lead us? What questions would it lead us to ask? What would it tell us about our understanding of consumer attitudes? What would it tell us about our ideas of social progress? What would it tell us about how we negotiate our entire social world through the realm of material goods? How material goods are a language to us. And we use that language not just to do the basic functional things of eating, of shelter, of clothing, but actually of talking to each other, speaking to each other, of telling stories about our identity, about our affiliation, about who we belong to, about what is important to us, about how we see the future, about how we care for our children, about how our communities matter. And when you begin to see consumption, when you begin to see material things as a language through which we talk to each other in this way, then it becomes more obvious that actually the consumer-based economy is an economy with stories to tell. It's an economy with a sense of hope that it's trying to propagate. It's trying to talk about a hope for the future. The future is a world where everything is bright and new and shiny, where things are newer and brighter this year than they were before, and where my children's world will be brighter still. And it is a story actually that is grasping for prosperity. It is a story that is reaching out through material stuff towards other people and towards the future and saying, this is a world that I want to be better. Even consumerism actually within itself has human stories, is a human story. It is our human story, us in this room more than those in Rio a couple of weeks ago. And this understanding to me then became the basis for asking more fundamental questions about the success of that strategy as a vision of progress, as a vision of who we are as people, as a sense of the satisfaction of our deepest philosophical and spiritual needs. Consumerism has failed in certain respects. It's been wildly successful in improving the material profligacy of our lives, and yet it's left out certain basic things. It's left out the sense of a world in which my prosperity hangs on the prosperity of those around me. It's left out the sense of a world where our concerns are much more social and psychological than they are material. It's left out the strength of my connection to my community. And it's these things, in a way, it's this idea that in fact there are things that went missing in this consumer economy that gives us perhaps the best signal for hope in the future. It gives us a way of rebuilding a less materialistic world. It tells us, in fact, that the human heart is not a place in which we crave like kids in the candy shop for the latest gadgets and the latest toys and the biggest houses and the fastest cars and the best holidays in the sun just for the sake of material things, but because we care about each other. It's quite a profound realization. It's an oddly powerless one, though, in a system in which we have built our economies around consumption growth. And it's that I want to talk about mainly in the second half of my talk. As Matt mentioned, I published a couple of years ago a book called Prosperity Without Growth. It certainly changed the way that my life was working at the time. It's been an honor and a privilege, really, to have been able to take that work, as Matt says, trotting the globe. I'm sure there's a carbon footprint implication to that somewhere. We'll top that up afterwards. And one of the places that I took it was to Rio Plus 20. And I want to talk a little bit about some of the work that we presented there. Rio Plus 20, the future we want, it was called. One of the things that came into that conference was entered into the dialogue was the terminology of the green economy. Those of you with longer memories will probably recall that Michael Jacobs in 1991 published a book called The Green Economy. And in some sense, it provided the foundation for his career, which was then to go and work as a special advisor to Gordon Brown on environment. But green economy really came back as a term with the crisis. It came back with the idea that if we were in the middle of an economic crisis, a financial crisis, then what governments should do is to stimulate recovery. And if they stimulate recovery, then why not recover in a green way? Why not engage in green investment? The Green New Deal, it was called. I'm going to come back to that in a little while. But what I want to, one of the lessons, and it's a sad lesson in a way, of this attempt to put green economy into Rio, is that it's so easy to put two words together and so hard to garner agreement around them. The green economy actually from the very beginning turned out to be a contentious concept. The G77 in particular railed against it because they saw it as yet another Western idea being imposed on the development of the poorest countries and restricting how they could develop. This argument between the West and the developing countries, between the G77 and the US in particular, really I think was at the heart of the fact that Rio was, as I mentioned, as Sarah mentioned, a profound failure. This is what others said. It's the greatest failure of collective leadership since the First World War. Well, that's George. What would he say other than that? A shameful betrayal, though. Fiona Harvey, who used to work for the Financial Times, we should have sent the poets, she ends lyrically at the end. A race to the bottom. Paul Polman is the CEO of Unilever, and he sent Henry here today to defend that position on the panel. These are not people, the usual suspects. This is people standing up and saying, this approach to international politics, this approach to business, this approach to the economy actually has failed to deliver. The future we don't want is what the NGOs called it. And Jeffrey Sachs, very interesting World Bank economist, has towed a mainstream line on what economies should do and what economics is about and how growth matters for three decades. Is now beginning to say things like, well, perhaps growth is not a very good measure of social progress after all. We should measure some other stuff. We should measure how happy people are. We should measure life satisfaction. We should measure whether they have basic needs met. I've spent some time working on those issues. And so it's nice in a way that these guys, these big hitters, are really now beginning to say these things about measurement. But I want to just make a little cautionary tale about measurement. Let's take this measurement of GDP and the measurement of happiness, for example. Well-being, it's called in the literature. And suppose that you set up the measurements of each country, well-being on one side and GDP on the other, and you compared these measurements. You might want to see which countries were performing better in relation to certain outcomes, depending on how they scored. So let's set up a second measure, which is the difference between their well-being ranking and their GDP ranking. We'll just take the GDP ranking away from the well-being ranking, and those who are doing better in the GDP stakes have a higher ranking, a lower number will have a higher positive score. Those who are doing worse in the GDP stakes but better in the well-being stakes will have a lower number, possibly even a negative number. You'll see where I'm going in a minute. You could use this exercise. You could take, for example, a set of countries, arbitrary countries in Europe, and you could measure them according to this ranking, which is the difference between their well-being score and their GDP score. And you could then ask yourself the question, which of these countries would perform better in different circumstances? And just for the sake of argument, you might ask them to perform some form of sports, or let's say football. And then you find very interesting things happening. That Portugal has a higher score here than the Czech Republic, that Germany has a higher score than Greece, that Spain and France have higher scores. You might expect quite definitive outcomes if these countries came up against each other, but Italy and the UK actually might just end up in a penalty shootout. You'll recognize, of course, that one of the things I'm doing here is leading you down the blind alley, which we like to call the fallacy of misplaced concreteness. This is one of those measures which may not be indicating to us that the GDP is a better measure of progress than a measure of well-being. But I do want to say here, and it's slightly perverse, I want to actually argue for the importance of the GDP. We have spent, some of us, a lot of our career denigrating the GDP. We've argued that it's a poor measure of social progress. We've argued that it fails to account for capital. It fails to account for environment. It fails even to account for things like crime and congestion and ill health, which make our lives less worthwhile. So why is it important? And I want to point here to something which I call the dilemma of growth. The GDP is important because it poses politicians a very, very profound dilemma. If you want a capitalist economy and you want it to be more and more productive, if your economy doesn't grow, that productivity leaves you with a problem, which is how to employ people. If the economy doesn't go up, then unemployment goes up in an economy based on labor productivity. And that means the consumption goes down. There's less spending on the high street. That means that tax revenues are down to government. It means that deficits to government go up. It means that there's a bigger public expenditure deficit. There is a drain on the purse. The public sector debt goes up. The interest payments go up. The loan defaults go up. And here in this diagram is the visceral fear of the politician. Here is the fear about asking any question about growth. Here is the response that I had when, as SDC commissioner, I stood up in a room not unlike this one and announced that we were going to talk about the relationship between growth and sustainability. And I remember it very well. At the time, a Treasury spokesman stood up at the back and said, "Now I see what sustainability is all about. It's about going back to live in caves, isn't it?" And this level of visceral fear, actually, I believe, and it's taken me some time to get there, has to be taken seriously. If we want to be influential in the way that Sarah was saying, we have to understand where this visceral fear comes from, and we have to answer the questions that are being asked. So this dilemma of the growth, it seems to me, is the place to start. And the research questions that I'd like to point to that come out of this is economic growth required in advanced economies to maintain employment and stability? Can we get a stable economy without economic growth? Keynes once said that the basis of economics is to provide for social stability. So if your economy really goes down the pan, as soon as you don't get economic growth, then that's a direct threat to social sustainability. It's a direct threat to stability itself, and it is the right and the duty of government to defend economic growth. That might seem a perverse thing for the author of Prosperity Without Growth to say, but actually it's the foundation of the argument in that book. We also need to know whether the financial system requires growth in the real economy. Is it somehow driving growth by this speculative market of financial trades that led to the spectacular collapse that we saw in 2009? One of the things that we can say for sure is that that system itself led to instability, an instability we still haven't recovered from. But that doesn't in itself absolve us from the task of showing that it's possible to have a different financial system. It's possible to negotiate stability in a different way. It's possible to have an economy not driven by consumption growth. And ultimately, the underlying question is, will restraints on demand of whatever reason, whether it's Eurozone crisis, whether it's sovereign debt, whether it's misguided austerity policies, whether it's voluntary restraint by consumers because they've had enough at last, or whether it's us putting in place ecological limits in a meaningful way, what will be the impact on the stability of our economies? None of us can sit here and argue that we want a society in which the economy collapses. For our children, for their children, it would be a disaster. So these are primarily the tasks that Peter Victor and I have taken on since we were, as it seemed, the only two people in the world to have written books with the two words "without growth" in the title. It seemed like a quite good thing that we should collaborate rather than compete with each other. And it's been a fascinating collaboration for me. It still isn't over. It was one of those tasks that you realize almost as soon as you undertake it that you should have started it 10 years ago at least. And so I fully expect it to outlast me here in CES. And I just want to, in the last few minutes, point though, because one of the justifications for all the work that Ian and Gemma and my students and my researchers have done in my absence and on my behalf has been that I've been working so hard on this. So it's payback time, in a sense. I want you to know a little bit about what we've been doing and why. And I hope that you can make sense of it, though I'm not sure I can, so it's not necessarily taken as read. What is this is a model that we have developed, and it is a model. It does use economic concepts, and it uses it advisedly, recognizing, in fact, that we have to be able to speak economics to economists. It takes a systems dynamics perspective. It incorporates financial, real, and environmental variables. It sets up integrated balance sheets. This will make a little more sense as I go through the last few slides. It looks at green and conventional current and capital expenditures. It has at its heart an input-output submodel, which I've spent a long time at Surrey working on this kind of model. It's useful particularly in articulating the relationship between real economy and environmental flows. It looks at some of the debates around the variable work week. Should we work less if there's less to be had in terms of employment? And it looks at demography, at population. It has a set of assumptions. I'm giving you the background of the model. You don't, at this point in the evening, after five separate talks, you're not expected to take it all in. I won't test you afterwards. What I do want to do is give you a sense, though, of what lies behind this complexity, a sense of the fact that we've done a pretty good job in ecological economics of linking the real economy with the natural economy. Modern monetary theorists have done a pretty good job linking the money economy with the real economy. What this model is trying to do is to put those things together, because without some sense of the financial economy, the money economy, we can wave our hands forever about green growth and the potential for technology and the investment in renewables, but we have to be able to show where the money comes from. And I want, if I can, this is very, very ambitious. I have on this, you'll see at the bottom, for those of you who like it, I have equations. Anyone who looked at the finance sector and what happened in the crash in any detail knows that the money economy is an incredibly complicated thing. Almost astonishingly, though, it is bounded by one simple equation here. This equation says that the difference between savings and investment is equal to the difference between government spending and taxation plus the net trade in the economy. And basically it is saying a very, very simple thing, that private savings is balanced against public debt. This might seem quite an odd thing to listen to when you have a government who is rapidly trying to persuade the private sector to spend more money and at the same time to reduce its sovereign debt. If there was a single national accounting economist who had looked at what the government was trying to do in the context of this identity, they would have realized you can't do it. You can wave your hands about investment. You cannot change the way that these rules work within the accounting system of the money economy. This is what's called a simplified transaction table. It's just really what people spend and what they get as income. So here, for example, is what households do. You have 100 units, let's say, of expenditure. You fund that out of your wages income, which is around 140. You pay some of that to government taxes, around 40 in this economy. You pay a bit of interest on bills, and you get a bit of profit from your investments. And what you're left with, the sum of all that column, is what you can then save in the economy. And then you can do this for all the sectors. What is most interesting about this is that at the end of the day, it all adds up. The savings of one sector are the borrowings of another sector. And if you put the rest of the world in there, the trade with the rest of the world in there, what you find at the end there is a big row of noughts. And at the bottom, those things also have to balance. So the sum of all those things has to balance as well. So our private positive net saving in this example can only be balanced against the government deficit. That's the way the system works. What is the implication of this? The implication of this is, let's change something. Let's say governments tax more and ask for a shift in taxation. So now we're taxing households a bit more. Government has a higher income. That's good. That's changed the balance of its own savings. It's improved its position, but now households no longer have money to save. It's a very, very simple illustration of the way in which the money markets work. And its point is to illustrate that unless you can integrate this into your understanding of green investment, this into your understanding of the green economy, you can't conjure sustainability out of nowhere. What we tried to do with this was to build a model that would reflect this. I want to just show you the pattern over time here in the UK. And you can see this playing out, this balance playing out very, very clearly in this diagram. And what you have is a sense of transition between 2000 and 2011, where two things have happened in this balance between savings and borrowings in different sectors. The first of them is that there has been a complete shift in government's position. Government was basically a net saving position at the beginning of 2000, and by the end of 2011, just by the crisis, it's in a net borrowing position. But that can only have happened if someone else's wealth, someone else's savings has gained. And what you see there is the winning sectors, the corporate sector, has improved its financial position. It's now a net saver. And to some extent, the rest of the world stayed the same, and households, interestingly, households improved their net savings position as well, although that happened very, very fast at the point the crisis hit. This is the kind of way that you can ask questions about the system. It doesn't lie to you. It tells you where the money is, and it tells you what the limits are of what you can achieve in terms of a green economy. We wanted to take this and to articulate, first of all, whether we could do exactly what Sarah said. Could we play? Could we test the world? Could we ask questions which said, this is a different model of how money should work? This is how we might structure institutions differently. This is how we might build an economy differently. We haven't got that far yet. What I want to show you really, and this I give full credit here to my collaborator, Peter Victor, what I want to show you is some very, very illustrative results that show that it's possible to ask these kinds of questions. So very, very simply, we constructed four scenarios. And we looked at the GDP in the scenarios, we looked at the greenhouse gases, and then we looked at some of the balance sheet impacts. What happens to the balance sheet when different sectors have to respond to each other's savings positions? And these were a sort of business as usual scenario. A second scenario was to say, well, let's assume that consumers do some of this work, that we do exactly what Sarah said, that we do it ourselves, that we spend more frugally. What happens in such an economy? What happens in an economy in which we attempt to do a lot of the things that have been talked about a lot in the green economy work, invest in greener ways, slow down some of the growth in government expenditure, shift our consumption to services, and perhaps reduce working hours? Can we put these things together in a model and see what it looks like? And then in the final one, we test the two assumptions of household frugality in the green economy together. So, here, very, very simply, you're going to be so disappointed because actually it's very, very simple what we've shown, but it is also quite telling. It tells you what are the limits on our imagination, what are the limits on our ability to transform a system that behaves in certain ways, and where should we intervene to change it. So here was our business as usual scenario. Growth goes up, everyone would like that. Greenhouse gases also go up. I should say that these data are quite firmly based in the Canadian economy, and the projection for greenhouse gases was taken from an official source. What is the most interesting part of this is to say, what happens to balance sheets here? What can we say about the balance sheet? And here is what happens to net household worth in this sector. So it more or less holds its own, holds its own. It's not a massive housing price bubble. It's not a fantastic laying down of savings, but households are at least still maintaining their net worth. Government debt, on the other hand, is higher. So what would happen here if households said to themselves, I'm not too happy with the fact that my net worth barely rises above what it was in 2010. So in the next 20 years, I'm going to save a bit more. I'm not going to spend so much. I'm going to be more frugal here. And our second scenario just shows that you can do this. This works. You can put this assumption into the model. Interestingly, the GDP doesn't change that much because the economy shifts more to investment and some to a different balance of trade. And households are able to protect their net worth. So you can model here actually an improvement in the net worth of households. From what I've said up to this point, though, you should be able to guess what's going to happen to the fourth line. What has to happen if one sector is laying down its savings and protecting its net worth? It has to have, because it's a balance sheet, an impact somewhere else. And in this case, it does. The debt to GDP ratio rises to something like 180%. So this is an example of a way in which the economy balances itself through a set of institutions that may or may not be acceptable in terms of a green economy. I want to very quickly talk about the green. I know I'm pushing up against time here a little bit, and the questions that you all have about probably not economic modelling at this point. But I want at least to show you a little bit of the green economy work. Saving the green economy, I called this talk, and I called it that because I believe there's a set of ideas that are important and that have gone missing out of Rio. They don't exist in the Rio Declaration. They don't exist in the fight between the developing nations and the West around what the green economy means. And they are important to the future of sustainability. They include the idea of greening investment, of transitioning towards resource productivity, low carbon technology, the protection of ecological assets. I also believe that the idea of enterprise as service, as a set of service-based activities, something that Walter championed all those years ago before he met Roland, is a critical part of what the green economy is. But you have to put these things together. You have to build up a sense of what an ecological macroeconomics does. You have to draw in these questions about work and leisure and how much we should work and how much we should not. And you have to make sure, ultimately, what's at stake here, I would argue, is stability. It's the stability of the society on which our children's health and future depends. This is a real intellectual task. Yes, nerdy task. Yes, I put my hand up to that. It is geeky in many of its incarnations. It does involve getting horribly dirty with data. It involves talking to neoclassical economists. It involves having conversations with central bankers. And it also involves, I think, continual trial and error, the trial and the retrial that says, what could our economy look like? Here is an economy that takes on board some of the features that I pointed to: slower growth in government spending, a transition to green investment, a shift to a service-based economy, and perhaps reduced working hours to maintain employment in a decent range. This is an economy that has a half-decent chance of reaching carbon targets. By 2035, it's round about 50% of the greenhouse gas emissions in Canada, on its way to a decent 80% target by 2050. And ironically, it's an economy in which the debt to GDP ratio, after rising for a bit, falls. Government is happy here. But this is not an economy that households are happy with. In fact, the net worth of households has collapsed. So what I'm showing you here is that you can dream all you want about green investment, but unless you can stack up these basic identities that sit around a very simple equation, you can't actually deliver the goods. And I have to say, in all humility, that Peter and I haven't delivered the goods either. What we've said is, what happens if households say, this net worth is no good for me, I want to protect my net worth. Well, here's a very similar scenario in which the household behavior changes. They attempt to save more and spend less. They're a frugal household. They're being sustainable consumers. They're doing what we're all asking people to do, and they're relatively successful at it. The household net worth is again protected, and we all breathe a sigh of relief until we see the final line, which is that the debt to GDP ratio for government has risen beyond what is currently acceptable. Okay, I want to finish and I want to get out of here as fast as possible. What are the key messages that I would like you to draw from this? I think they are three or fourfold. First, that the green economy cannot be plucked out of thin air. It must address this fundamental question of social stability and the visceral fear of the politician in reaction to that stability. Quite justified fear, I would argue. And in doing that, it must accommodate these trade-offs. It must actually draw its boundaries within a financial economy that behaves in the way that the money economy behaves. But the second thing, and this is where I come to Sarah's point, is that the power to change depends on our ability to imagine solutions and to understand what the options are. And these trade-offs, the ones that I've showed you already, are already ideologically laden. They are value-laden trade-offs. For example, you will hear from the mouths of government that it is a bad thing that the debt-to-GDP ratio rises. In an economy in which the power to create money is handed from the central bank to the commercial banks, it is a very bad thing for the debt-to-GDP ratio to rise. In an economy in which government has the power to create money and in fact, to invest that money in social goods to the benefit of most people, it's a very, very different set of circumstances. So my point here is that within this complexity of the financial economy is a set of institutional assumptions, a set of ideological assumptions that we have to question. I was in a debate recently with a former president of the Brazilian Central Bank, and he said to me quite disingenuously, yes, it's true, we've created a system which seems to benefit the private risk takers and penalize those who carry the costs of those risks. Yes, it's true that we have privatized gains and we have socialized losses. And that is the position that we live in at the moment in a central bank that has handed over the power of the creation of money to private institutions that then charges interest on that money to the people who want to invest it in the benefit of community in the economy as a whole. Governments are paying for the private gains that are being reaped through creation of money and are unable to invest in the things that this economy would want us to do. This kind of model, this kind of exploration, this kind of tracking through the system allows us to see where that happens and why it happens. And this is my final point, really, that this is about an exploration. Which alternatives exist? What kind of financial system exists? What kind of central bank do you need to operate? How is money created? How is debt maintained? How is the debt to GDP ratio managed? What is the role of the public sector in accepting debt to GDP ratios? What is the structure of sovereign debt? If it exists as a contract between us as citizens and our government in pursuit of social ends, it's a very different thing than if it exists as a set of immense fragilities in international currency markets. So these are the places, I believe, where the exploration has to go. I wanted to say something philosophical at the end. I've run myself out of time to do so, but perhaps we can talk about it in discussion. I suppose my underlying point here is that we don't have to dream about changing people's nature. We don't have to dream about changing values. The values actually are laid down and have been laid down for some time. Some of us are aware of our own selfish values, but we all of us are aware that that isn't exhausting who we are as human beings. Many of us are driven by the pursuit of novelty but none of us ever steps outside some sense of the tradition that grounds us in the conservation of our natural world and our communities and our societies. What we have done, and it does speak to the rather rushed presentation I gave you about modelling, what we have done is we've created a set of institutions that completely ignores three quarters of that quadrant and focuses on the novelty-seeking, selfish consumer. The work that Peter and I are doing, the work that I've been doing in Resolve, the work that CES has been doing, I believe has been a way of saying that actually this transition is not hair, shirt and sandals. It's about opening our perspective about what it means to be human beings and actually perhaps becoming human for the first time in a long time. Thank you very much.